Hey, everybody. Ham Radio Now, episode 186. 100 years of ham radio experience starts now. Well, what could that possibly be all about? I'm Gary Pierce, Scan4AQ. We'll find out what that's all about. I did an interview. I've already recorded it. I'm doing the introduction a little bit later. Out of sequence, because the fellow I was talking to had a hard deadline that I completely blew out of the water and went way longer than we were planning on. So, yes, this is going to be another classic Ham Radio Now interview. But before you even get to that, I got email from a ham in Puerto Rico, Angel Santana, WP3GW. And Angel wanted to do a conversation on their convention coming up, the ARRL convention, Puerto Rico State Convention, because the ARRL doesn't have territory conventions. And I wanted to do a more in-depth conversation with him on hamming in Puerto Rico, as long as I was going to be talking to him. Let's get into what hamming is like down there in our potential 51st state, I guess. But Angel didn't have a really good internet signal. So we recorded just a really quick conversation about the convention, because that's coming up the end of this month in January. And so we'll talk to him, and then I will get back to the main subject of today's interview, 100 years of ham radio experience starts now. But first, here's Angel.
Can I put a couple big chair also?
Now you look okay. Angel. ¿Cómo está? Buenas tardes.
Buenas tardes, Gary.
That's all the Spanish that I know. You have a convention coming up, right, at the end of January?
Yes, we have the third Puerto Rico State Convention. It's going to be on January 24th, 25th, here on the Francisco Pancho Deida Coliseum in Atillo. It's the third convention.
That is in San Juan?
It's near Arecibo.
Oh, it's out near Arecibo. All right.
Yeah, in the northwestern part of the island, yes, in the coast. It's in the coast.
Okay. So if hams are coming out to visit Puerto Rico, take a look at the weekend of the convention. And if you're coming out for things like that, well, a tour to Arecibo would also be very cool. So you got a lot going on there.
Yeah. The day before the convention, we're going to have a reception. Before that, we're going to have to go to the observatory of Arecibo, a VIP for Arecibo. Then on the 24th and the 25th, the gates open at 9 a.m. for the convention.
All right. Where is more information available? What's the website?
Okay. For more information on where it is, who is coming, all the information, you can go to www.arrl.com.
Hola, soy Kay Craigie, N3KN. Hi, I'm Kay Craigie, N3KN, president of the American Radio Relay League.
Yes, you can get information there about the hotels, who's coming, the fall contest university, Caribbean edition, first time Caribbean contest university is coming to Puerto Rico.
Okay, you've got a lot of the ARRL big shots coming down to see you, don't you?
Yeah, we're going to have the presidents of the AR, K. Craigie and 3KN. We're going to have...
Okay, it looks like our internet connection is breaking up a little bit. But we'll take a look at your website, and maybe we'll get a few more mainland hams to come visit Puerto Rico. And if not for this convention, we'll think about it... for any vacation or for next year. And we are going to try to put together a little bit better internet signal. And we'll talk more about hamming in Puerto Rico as soon as we can. Thank you very much, sure. Angel. Gracias, amigo.
Gracias, Gary, for the opportunity. And remember, January 24, 25, Francisco Pancho Deida and Atillo, Puerto Rico, our third ARRL Puerto Rico State Convention. If you want to escape the winter, come on down to Paradise. Thank you.
Escape the winter. It sounds good to me. 73, yeah. Amigo.
73, 73. Right.
So this is what we're really going at with this 100 years of ham radio experience beginning today. Okay. Yep. Laughing in the background is an old friend of mine, Rich Casey. I know you as WA9LRI. That's not going to do, right. Is it? It's M5CSU now, right?
Right, for 35 years.
Okay. And let me show people what I'm talking about. Today is an auspicious day for me. I don't have my original license anymore. That got lost a long time ago, but this is my original logbook, a little bit worse for wear. I think you can still buy these logbooks from the ARL. And today, as we record, is January 11th, 2015. And this logbook begins January 11th, 1965. And it's in the faded, scratchy pencil of a 15-year-old ham. And there is my very first attempt at a contact, January 11th. That was a Monday. So my license came in the mail on a Monday. It made me wait through a whole weekend. And I called WN2NWJ. I was a novice on 40 meters in the novice band. I gave him a 339. He gave me a 589. And the contact lasted from 5:15, that would be p.m., until 5:17 p.m. So it didn't go long. And my first few contacts were pretty rough. There's a few more. And then finally here, this was my mentor, Bob, K9ZGT. Bob was the fellow that got me started in hamming. Not my original interest in communications and radio and electronics and stuff, but my interest in hamming. And the log goes on from there. Things become more successful, although not on this first day. But where you come into the picture is not in this logbook, but in this logbook, which for some reason I'm also calling book one. I don't know why. Dymos last for a long time. I notice that. February 6th, 1965. So about a month later. The reason that's a separate logbook is at that point I bought a Heathkit tour and started operating on 2 meter AM, something we can talk about the dangers of in just a moment. So I did a separate logbook on that. And evidently I built that somewhere in early February, and finally got it working. February 6th, I made a call. The radio didn't work when I first built it. There was something wrong. I think I had no transmit audio. And so on February 6th, I called this guy and he didn't answer. And you know, I don't know how I debugged that because I had no other way to listen to that signal. It was weird. But somehow I found out that they had no transmit audio. I'm really proud of myself because I fixed it. I found out what I had wired wrong, and I got it working.
A tough adjustment, perhaps.
Yeah, I mean, I had no technical skills back then. None. I don't know if we've got enough time to go into a lot of that stuff, but I'd love to talk about it, but we'll see. In any case, very soon after that, on February 18th, I guess that's when I got it working, there is WN9LRI. And that was you. We were both novices. And I hope that I sent you a PDF of that. I hope that brought something back.
Okay. Yeah. That's funny. Well, on that same page, well, first of all, let me tell you, I built my tour. Here's my surprise. Here's one.
You've got it.
Right here.
You got your original tour.
I bought this off of eBay a few months ago.
Okay.
For those hams that are newer than this, this is called a lunchbox. Because it has a handle. It's 5 watts, crystal controlled. It didn't have push to talk. You had to do it like this, like an intercom.
Yeah, that's been modified, by the way.
The volume, yeah, it has been a little bit. Here's the volume, and here's the entire 2 meter band.
Yes, 144 on the left, 148 on the top, 148 on the right, 145 on the top.
And then over here, this guy had actually, it's a crystal controlled radio. You put a crystal in for transmit.
Yeah.
This guy actually cut a hole so he could change frequencies, which is pretty cool. And it still has a little plastic thing. This is where you cut out your license. and you could put your ham license, it used to be this size, you could fit it in there and then carry it with you. Had a big old power plug on the back here.
Separate power supply, I believe.
Yep, and this was a regen receiver, which works pretty well, but is really noisy, and of course, no squelch back then.
Right.
So what you would do, you would call CQ with this thing, hello CQ, on your crystal, on your transmit frequency, then you go to receive, and then you just tune the whole band, and hopefully somebody would answer you.
Yes.
So
the modifications that I can see, if you hold it back up there, the mods that I can see are they changed the mic connector.
Yes, they used to have a microphone without a push-to-talk.
Yeah.
Looked like a tape recorder microphone, yep. Square thing.
And he cut the hole in the back, or in the side, to be able to reach the crystal. And he changed the antenna connector.
Oh, that's right. It was a phono plug, wasn't it?
It was.
Yeah, yeah.
And one story I'd like to take enough time to relate to show just how little I knew about what was going on back then is that Bob and I, K9ZGT, and I built a 2-meter beam. I looked in the handbook to see if it was in the handbook. I couldn't find the design for it. Just a simple 5-element 2-meter beam. It was fed with twin lead, 300-ohm twin lead. And so I brought twin lead down to the shack and soldered it into the RCA connector and into the antenna. I didn't know. The contact that you and I made, and we made many more, looking down the log. That's how that expression came looking, let's see you down the log. Working with that 300-ohm twin lead, of course, the radio wanted to see 50 ohms, not 300 ohms, and it worked. It worked fine. I was telling
them. Well, the radio didn't know any better.
I'm sure the tube got a little hotter or, you know, unhappy. And the standing wave was high. So the radio, the input power of the radio was 5 watts. The output power was probably about 2 watts. And I probably put out about a watt or less with what was being reflected in. But you still heard me. So my license was arrived on January 11th. 1965. You were still a novice, but you were a little bit ahead of me.
Right. Yeah. And we've always had a competition, Gary. So I hit my 50th anniversary before you ever will. So there you go. I got my license in June of 64, but I didn't have any equipment. I'd taken the ham class at the Notre Dame High School in Niles, which had a terrific club station. It was all Hallicrafters equipment donated by Phil Halligan, who ended up being a member of our club. But, I passed my novice in June, and then I had to wait for school so I could use the school station. So my first QSO was in September of 64, and that guy never QSL'd. So I still don't have
That must have killed you all that summer.
Oh, yeah, it was crazy. It was crazy. I talked my dad into buying me a night kit, which was then owned by Radio Shack, a T60 transmitter, and a Radio Shack regen receiver. And I put up some bell wire dipole. Well, it wasn't a dipole, it was just a long wire. Some bell wire cost about $1 at the hardware store. And I had one crystal, of course, and I worked 40 meters. And I remember getting an ARRL magazine. I couldn't afford to be a member. And I found out about a dipole. So I built this dipole. I was so happy. I ran up to the roof. I replaced this just long wire with a perfectly cut dipole. I assumed because I didn't know anything about SWR and couldn't afford a bridge.
So you didn't know any more than I did.
No.
We were both.
I came downstairs and I was so excited that now I knew I had a real ham radio antenna dipole. And there was a guy on my frequency calling CQ, you know, with Morse code. And we were both kind of shaky doing our 5-word-a-minute thing back then. I called him. He didn't answer. He kept calling CQ. I kept answering. So I ran outside. The ladder was still up. I ran up to the ladder, ripped the dipole apart, twisted it all back together, hooked it to the coax, ran downstairs, and he gave me a 599. So right then, I realized that antennas are a lot of art and a little bit of science.
You fixed it.
I fixed it, yeah. And then we worked then I got a Heathkit tour for my birthday and built it. And amazing, it's the exact same problem, Gary. Everything, you know, I turned it on, it lit up, it seemed to receive, although, you know, I couldn't hear anything, and I kept calling CQ and nobody would answer me. So I took it to school and took it to the club guys who were generals and knew what they were doing. And they said, wow, this radio does work, but there's no audio. And inside, right inside the mic here, there is a toroid, I believe, that has to go to the center sheet, the center only, and not grounded. And what they did was I had accidentally bent it a little bit and it was grounded. So as soon as they ungrounded it, I had audio. So I ran home with my little tour on the bus and started working people. So I had only had the radio for probably 2 months, Gary. So you were one of my first 2 meter AM contacts too. So
yeah, you were gonna look for your old log. Did you find one?
Yeah, except it's at the lake. It's at our lake house. So I do have
yours
in there.
You've got a lake house.
yeah, it's a little cottage. Now I've got something else I want to show you, Gary. Do you remember this?
It's a fiberglass 2 meter 5/8 wave antenna. Is it a Hustler?
Yeah. I think we called it a Helio Whip back then.
Yeah. I don't remember what brand it was.
I got this from you. We traded for something. You had this and I just wanted one so bad because I could put a little adapter and put it on the back of the tour, you know, and be a real portable station as long as the cord would, you know, plug in somewhere. And so I traded this with you, probably in 65 or 66. And, you wanted it back so bad that every time we'd have a QSO, you'd say, I really want that whip back. What can we trade? And I would never trade it back. So I actually used
it. Okay, now I remember I'm still mad at you.
Yeah, so I still have it. I ran out in the garage. I had it on my Jeep for a while a couple years ago, and every time I used it, I had a laugh about it. Because I don't know what in the world we were doing on vertical polarization, because we all used horizontal polarization on AM. I don't know.
The timing for that was probably a little later than what you're thinking. And first of all, I want to explain something to the audience. I'm going to rely on you for a lot of anecdotal memories because there's something about the way my mind works. And I remember in snapshots, but I don't remember in very many stories. And I did better, but all across my life, even thinking about things that happened 5 years ago, I can see images, but I can't remember whole stories. And I rely on people around me to tell me, which, you know, is just a really, useful, capability for someone who's in the broadcasting business where stories are so important. But, so as you remember things, it'd be cool to bring them up. The reason I'm thinking that that your time frame for that is a little bit off is the snapshots I've got are the way I used that antenna. It was for FM. And we were both fairly early into FM. Yeah. Now, something about that tour is was AM. And in 1965, FM and repeaters existed, but they just barely existed. In Chicago, a major metropolitan area, there were at that time, probably two repeaters. In California, there were probably a big handful. New York City, other cities. You know, in almost every major metropolitan area, there was one or two 2 meter repeater. Mm-hmm. And in Chicago, there was a couple. And we became involved in that. We'll talk about that in a little bit. But in 1965 and through the next couple of years, there's barely any FM. It was brand new stuff. So the 2 meter band was pretty much empty, and it was a good thing because that tour heard about 50% of the band at any dial setting. didn't matter where you were. I had a Crystal for 145.8. Now, better radios, radios that had some activity was concentrated at about 145 to 145.3, 145.4. For some reason, I had a Crystal at 145.8. The only people I talked to were other people with tours. Because they were the only people that could hear me. Everybody else never tuned up that high. So other people with tours. So, yeah, we were horizontal. And in the early days of FM, I put on the back of my dad's car an 8-foot mast, topped by a horizontal 2 meter antenna called a cloverleaf, three element right. cloverleaf design. And suddenly I don't remember what the name of that was. And on top of that was that fiberglass whip. It probably went up to about 15 feet. It probably got, if you look at the top, I wouldn't be too surprised if it isn't whacked by bridges and stuff.
It is missing the cap. I wondered about that.
Yeah. So I used that for FM and I'm not sure what I did when I sold it to you. But yeah, I probably wanted to get back on FM.
Yeah, that makes sense. That makes sense. And at that point, we both got involved with the Chicago FM Club. And we were both on the board. I think I was the president for a while. You were president for a while. And it's really fun. The Chicago FM Club is still around. And they have Echo Link. And I Echo Link in occasionally just to hear the old WA9ORC CWID. So it's really cool.
Look at this.
Oh, my gosh. There it is. Squelch Tail.
This is every Squelch Tail in the era that I was part of the Chicago FM Club. This one is from 1973. You were the president, had just become the president in 1973, and I became the vice president in 1975, and the president in 1979.
I think after I moved to Texas. Yeah,
you moved to Texas. Your QRZ page says you moved to Texas in 78, I think.
Right.
So you bailed out of there early, and I actually bailed out of ham radio entirely in the late 1979, 1980, after my term expired. We were in our 20s. I'm 65 right now. You're probably, what, a year older than me?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you were probably a freshman when you took the course and going into your sophomore year.
Right. Yeah, I had learned the Morse code on my own in 7th and 8th grade using a Remco 100 milliwatt transmitter, and I would call CQ on 910 kilohertz, 20 KCF from WLS, and no one ever answered me back, but occasionally I would hear CW, and it turned out it was the second harmonic down from the 160 meter band. So I would think, hey, there's actually other CW here on the AM broadcast band. So by the time I got to high school, I already knew most of the letters. I did not know da 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 it, you know, the slash mark. And there were about 20 of us in a novice class. They would, after school, we'd go into the language lab, and one of the guys would send Morse code through the language lab on these headphones. And I remember every time they would send da 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 it, everybody would go, and the instructor would get so mad. So, yeah, I got my, back then you had 1 year to upgrade when you got your novice, which was very easy. It was 5 words per minute code. That was probably the hardest. And I think was it 25 questions?
I don't remember what the
question
was.
Pool.
But yeah, we had because we weren't allowed to see the actual questions back then.
Right.
We had the ARRL license manual, which gave us an idea of what was going to be there. But today you see the actual questions. You can see all of them.
Yeah. Which is pretty amazing.
But back then, I know what they did with the commercial licenses is they would send people to take the course or to take the test at the FCC, and you had to take your commercial and everything above novice in ham radio, take it at an FCC office. And people would come out of that and write down all the questions they could remember as fast as they could before they forgot them. And they were hired by the people who taught the commercial courses. I don't know how the ARL figured out what to ask or put in the license manual.
Oh.
There might have been some of that going on.
Yeah, I didn't know that. Now, I remember I had my tech, and you were still a novice on 2 meter AM. And then, so when I would call you, I would say W novice 9 novice sugar ocean. This is W A for alpha 9 LRI. And I know it used to really hack you off. So
yeah, but I got even.
General.
I got
you
even.
Did.
I got the you general did. First.
And I was a tech for a long time.
Yeah. And the trap was that novice license was, as you say, good for a year and could not be renewed. But allowed voice privileges on 2 meters. And I'm sure you were warned, as I was warned, Don't use your novice year talking on 2 meters. Use it building up your Morse code, or you're not going to be able to get up to 13 words a minute and your license will expire. But they had that exit strategy for people who weren't able to get to the 13 words a minute, the technician license.
Yeah. And that was it. I know I waited 11 months and realized, whoa, I'm going to be off a 2 meter AM.
You talk to me on 2 meters too much.
I think, and WA9FNQ, Bob Tolchin, who's a longtime ham. You worked, actually, Bob, in that log before me. So we've been friends for 50 years. And he was actually licensed when he was like 12. So he had beat us by several years. But I remember I took my general. Actually, it was a friend of mine at work when I was working at Kemper Insurance who was a general. And he said, I'm going to loan you a rig and a keyer. And what I want you to do, and I'd never used a keyer before, he said, I want you to turn it all the way down. And with a Heathkit keyer, you know, you press it one way. Actually, you'd press it one way and it would make dots. But the other one, you had to do the dashes, I think, manually. He said, I want you to turn it all the way down. So it's about 3 words a minute. I want you to have 1 CW QSO a night. But every night, I want you to turn that knob up 1 hair. And he said, come back in 60 days and tell me if you're not at 13 words a minute. And sure enough, in 60 days, I did. So myself and a friend drove down to downtown Chicago. I listened to a Morse code of random letters at 20 words a minute on my Walkman all the way down for about an hour. I had the headphones on while he was driving. We went into the FCC, the building next door to the FCC building, and I had a glass of wine for lunch and a sandwich. Went up the elevator with the Walkman on my ears at 20 words a minute, walked in and said, I want to take the code test. And he said, fine. There were like 3 other guys. They sat down, he turned it on, and I swear the code sounded like about 5 words a minute because I had tricked my brain listening to 20 words per minute randomly, not even trying to write them down. And I took that test. I was sure that it was actually the novice test because it sounded so easy. Passed it, and we walked downstairs, and I had another glass of wine. So got my general in 76, and then this past year, I finally got my extra. It was my 50th year as a ham, and I thought, you know, it is time to get my extra. It was on my bullet list, and so I finally got it this past year, and it was a big kick. But it took me 50 years to get there, so I know you beat me there, Gary.
Yeah, I beat you there, too, because I got my extra in 2000, which was a magical time in ham radio. In the year 2000, April 15th, 2000, the code requirement dropped. It wasn't eliminated. It was dropped for the extra from 20 words a minute to 5. And, well, Morse code had never been a problem, also never been a passion. And my top code speed hovered around 18 or so. I didn't use it very much. I did want to point out something, though. I did make lots, get to the camera here, lots of Morse code contacts as a novice. So unlike you, I made plenty of CW contacts. And then here, on May 12th of 1965, from this point on, X is WA9NSO.
Ooh,
and
yeah.
I didn't note that it was a general, but the contacts are still on HF, so it was a general.
What does that say, good?
The good Gary Good was written by my brother, who was my nemesis. He beat me to ham radio. He was, my brother Andy, was WN9MAB, the master amateur bootlegger. And he was also a friend of Bob, and he got his novice before we went to school. It was the summer before our freshman year at high school, and I got mine in a ham radio class at high school. I'll give a shout out to the late Charles Rocky, W9SCH. Charles Rocky taught a full credit science course at New Trier High School in Winnetka, Illinois, called Amateur Radio. He was quite an inspiration.
Wow.
This was a huge high school. Niles High School was probably also a pretty huge high school, I imagine.
Yeah, I went to Notre Dame.
Oh, so Notre Dame, okay.
Yeah.
I was a private school, but it's also probably pretty big.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah.
All boys.
There were about 4,000 students in New Trier.
Well, that's a big figure, yeah.
Yeah, it was huge. in that there were probably 30 or 40 licensed hams and 15 or 20 first-class phones, which was way beyond me. But he, yeah. I mean, he just did a great job in a full credit license class. I would also like to, for the record, state that I failed the first semester. I got my novice license, which was a requirement only for getting an A in the class. But a requirement for passing the first semester was turning in all your homework. And I failed to turn in the last homework assignment on characteristic curves because I didn't understand them. And I was a terrible student and I didn't know how to go ask for help. So I didn't turn it in. And he said, no, you can't pass. You fail. It was, by the way, the beginning of a significant series of failures in high school. I failed almost everything. I got out of high school in 5 years, 5.5 years with an F+, only because they wanted to get rid of me.
Yeah.
Anybody who's watched the programs knows I'm not that stupid. It's just that lost. I mean, high school was a terrible time. College was great. Went from one dean's list in high school to the other in college. College was fine. I, you know, aced everything in college because I didn't take any math. Me and Barbie, math is hard. You went into an engineering career. You clearly.
No, I didn't. No, my degree's in English, believe it or not. I hung out at the radio station at Loyola. We had campus radio station, AM, believe it or not. But I ended up with
We both went to Loyola, but at different times.
Yeah.
And you might not have known, I went to Loyola.
I did not know that.
Yeah, that's where I went to college.
Was it Carrier Current AM radio then?
Yeah, WLUC.
WLUC, yep. Yep. In fact, I went in and upgraded the Wikipedia article about Loyola to show that WLUC AM existed because it wasn't in there. When I graduated, I went to work for Kemper Insurance and set up an audio video studio for them. And I was only able to do that because I had met a bunch of hams from Chicago FM Club that worked at CBS. So I was hired at Kemper as a writer and a trainer. And when they said they were going to go into audio video, I said, you know, I know that. And they said, you do? And I said, oh, I can build you a studio and I can direct your stuff. And I immediately got on the repeater that night and said, hey, you guys at CBS, you got to help me. So I was learning on the fly about 2 weeks ahead of what I needed to know at Kemper. So I stayed there for 8 years. We moved to Texas and I ended up being hired at E-Systems, which is a engineering electronics defense engineering company that works primarily with the three-letter government agencies as a technical writer. And then a couple years later, I bid out into division support and got involved with IT and so forth. But my degree is in English. Once I got on E-Systems, I realized that most engineers can't write a complete sentence. So I figured they knew the engineering and I knew how to write. So, and I could kind of understand them. They could understand me because of my background in ham radio. So it turned out to be a great career, but I'm still self-taught in computers, electronics, and anything above Ohm's law, I still have a little bit of trouble with. But
so ham radio turned out to be a real asset for you as it did for me.
Yes, absolutely.
I consider myself to be an appliance operator, both in ham radio and in my career. My career had been in television, and so I didn't know we paralleled quite that closely. Although
And actually, I got my job at E-Systems I was writing. Remember the Squelch Tale? I wrote a column from the president, and somebody changed it to WNLRI. Heard because that's the way I said my call so fast. When I moved to Texas, I joined the Garland Amateur Radio Club and kept my WNLRI column. And a guy, Ham, K5HTK, here in Dallas, hired me to E-Systems because of my writing of in the Garland Amateur Radio Club newsletter. There it is, WNLRI.
Yeah.
So
I almost wasn't ready for this interview because I'd spent so much time looking through the old Squelch Tales. Ciders, because that's the club newsletter here in Raleigh that I edited for a while.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so,
One of the things, what happened was E-Systems was purchased by Raytheon, and at that time I was working in IT. I was a really, real early convert to the internet because we'd already been doing TCP/IP on ham radio. So I got involved with the internet, and from about 1994 on, I was pretty much doing internet content creation and editorial and so forth for Raytheon and for our division within Raytheon until I retired a couple years ago. Hey, but before we leave the 60s, I was thinking back. I noticed a guy in your log that you worked, and he never would talk to me because I was a teenager, so you must have been acting like an adult. There was a guy, W9YOI near yeah. Mundelein, still yes. kicking that gong.
The goofy old Chinaman.
Yeah, there you go. When he
was not Chinese.
No, of course not. But he had a gong next to his microphone, and when he would finish his chuso, he'd stay still kicking that gong. He'd kick the gong, and then he would drop his transmitter. So the last thing you'd hear is this gong, and then it would kind of fade away.
Yep.
I thought that was extremely cool. And then remember WB9LOZ, Larry?
Larry Kenny, yeah.
He was the chief engineer at Wizard, WZRD-FM Mono, at a college in Chicago, but they had the finest audio. Do you remember that?
I don't know how much I listened to him. It was Northeastern University, not Northwestern. Northwestern is the big school everybody knows. Northeastern is a small, maybe even a community college, but it's a small college in Chicago.
Yeah, it was amazing. All the hams knew. I mean, they had the best audio, and it was all Larry's doing. He moved to San Francisco, and he's still involved with the San Francisco Radio Club out there. I noticed that he's still involved.
Yeah, he got real deep into Packet for a while and wrote a lot of stuff that's still out there. You can still look it up and educational on Packet if anybody still wants to use Packet.
Yeah. WB9LOZ, and then did you remember WB9IEN, Howard Leventhal?
Yeah.
Who recently had kind of a skirmish with the law. I think he's going to end up spending some time in the federal pen.
I only remember him as being such a nice guy.
Yeah. He's his father owned a dealership in Chicago. He always had the coolest car because his dad had the auto dealership. And the other thing that I remember, and I wonder if you did this too, Gary, before I had my ham license, I used to get Popular Electronics.
Oh, yeah.
And they had a WPE program where you could get SWL call letters.
Mm-hmm.
And I was WPE9EZZ. Echo ZZ. Oh, I guess it was Easy Zebra Zebra back then in the phonetics we used to use. And that was the CW. When I called CQ on the AM band, I didn't have call letters, so I would use WPE9EZZ. And I thought that was, I can't believe. In fact, somewhere I still have a little plastic thing with the little call letters. So.
Yeah. I never did that. I was aware of it. I never did that. I was actually on the air ahead of my ham radio career. Through CB, the way a lot of people got into it. Did you ever do CB before you did ham radio?
Yeah, I actually did them both. I was involved with the North Shore Emergency Association, which was a very, very cool CB group, and then we formed a ham group there also. That was before the Good Buddies and all that. Everybody used their call letter, and it was a lot of fun.
Call letters, real names, pretty much English, pretty much.
Yeah,
I mean, 10-4, but... A lot of English.
There was a guy, and I grew up in Morton Grove, and you were in Winnetka, right?
Yeah.
There was a guy in Morton Grove, KHB2469, and he would call home. He was about 3-4 blocks away from me. And it was really funny because these are the things that stick in my brain. When he would finish the CUSO with his wife saying, "I'm on the Edens, I'll be home in 20 minutes," he'd say, "This is KHB2469, the Fox traveling." And I thought that was just the coolest thing.
Yeah, I remember that. I don't know if I ever talked to you on CB. I initially got on borrowing people's call signs because I was too young for a license. And my dad was non-technical. He was an insurance guy, so. He eventually had to get one because I had a falling out with the people that were loaning me their call signs as Unit 2. So KLJ7361 was the first CB license that we had in the family.
Yeah, I had my dad do it. I remember filling in it was a 6-part license and doing it on the typewriter. So he was KHD5402. And then at the minute I turned 16, I got KBJ7463, I think was my call. And I
think you had to be 18.
Was it 18?
You have compressed your childhood. I who am claiming to have poor memory, am at least getting a few of those things. Let me show you something here. W9YOY.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, I called him. He did not answer.
He did not answer.
I have a vague memory of him, and I know he wasn't the original. I don't think he was the original. But the phrase, no kids, no lids, no space cadets, comes to mind.
Yeah, and, that's right.
He may have picked that up from somebody, because that's a famous ham radio phrase from back in those days. I need to adopt now.
We'd have to explain the lids part, because that was you would send that if somebody really was so bad with Morse code that you'd call them a lid. And that was even worse than when you said QLF, which means now try sending with your left foot.
Yeah.
For that.
Yeah, the term lid seems to have faded a lot. Us old timers still remember what it is, but there's a club down here that has the Lid of the Month award that they pass around back and forth. It's a toilet. It's a fancy toilet seat, and if you open it up, there's a mirror inside, so you can open it up and see who the lid is. So,
oh my gosh,
the old timers, they still remember what that is.
I can't believe we're in the old timers club now. You know, it used to be we'd turn on the radio and you'd hear a couple of old guys saying, by golly, hi, hi.
I've managed not to say hi out loud on phone ever.
Those guys that don't know CW, hi means a laugh.
Yeah.
So if you did hi, hi, it's a very, big laugh.
Yeah.
Like LOL in today's world.
Yeah, it's like saying that in actual normal conversation. You and me talking here would say, LOL, as opposed to laughing. But hams get stuck with that sort of thing. So you'll still hear old timers go, hi. Yeah, it's just, I was up working on the antenna and I dropped my wrench. Hi, hi.
Yeah. Pretty sad.
Let's
not to do that here.
we do have something else to talk about, but I wanted to take, just because I prepared this stuff, I wanted to take a little trip down memory lane. This is... what am I pushing the wrong button? There we go. This is QST from 1965, our first year. I picked March rather than January because this is the issue that they would have put together in January, and it would come out in March. And somebody's doing moon bounce, it's a big deal. This is one of the radios I lusted after. A 2 meter, I guess that's it. Well, 2 meters and 6 meters individual monoband radios. We had the Tours with their low power and their regenerative receivers that were barn door receivers. And this had a superhet receiver. It was one of those that people using these radios would never hear me on 145.8 because they'd never tune up that high.
Right.
Back in that day, people used, it was still an era of separate transmitters and receivers. Transceivers were coming along, but a lot of people still use the separates. This is a Collins transceiver, and they're trying to convince people that it's worth buying these expensive radios, which it probably was. Let's see what they were, what the big deals were in that era. Oscar One had actually gone up in, I think, 1962, so it was up before we became ham. So they were up to Oscar Three. Teletype, using actual real teletype machines. Lots of, as QST still does, lots of technical articles.
There's Lou McCoy there.
Yeah.
W1ICP.
He's a very famous guy. Hamming from a fallout shelter. Let's see. I'll go through this. Whoops, stop that. Pay attention to what I'm asking you to do what I think I want you to do, not what I'm asking, actually telling you to do, computer. The Ranger 2, and let me see if I can zoom in on the text here, because this was an era of the crossover between AM and single sideband. So Johnson Company had been a powerhouse in transmitter, but all AM. They never made a full sideband transmitter that I know of. So in 1965, they're trying to get people to do AM. Some may call it ancient modulation, AM phone. but AM still represents a major portion of today's amateur activity. So they're trying to sell an AM radio, and, you know, sort of like good luck with that.
Yeah.
So let's see, what else is going on in 1965? The Radio Amateur Handbook. This is not one that I bought in 1965. I picked this up at a ham fest fairly recently. But because, you know, recognizing I was reaching this milestone, I came across that and picked it up. And what was it back then? $4.50. No, $4 in USA proper. A bit more expensive. Here's one of the things I was sort of getting at with starting from CB. This was an article, the editorial in QST. It was sort of admonishing hams who have nothing but contempt for CB operators, which I was and which you were. And, you know, and a lot of hams started there. And still today, a lot of hams still get their start in CB. What CB is, you know, now is very different than what it was back then. But a lot of hams still start.
If you remember, Gary, back in the when we first got on the Chicago FM Club repeater, we used the 10.8 and 10.7.
And a lot of people
in and check out.
Yeah, a lot of people on FM did, and some of my friends, Bob in particular, K9ZGT, who was not an FM aficionado. In fact, a lot of hams, HF oriented hams, looked at very askance at FM operation.
Yeah.
They didn't understand crystal control anymore. They didn't understand crystal control receivers at all. Required for FM. Not required, but required for repeaters. Didn't understand it. And I don't know if you ever heard this terminology, but CFMC, the Chicago FM Club, was referred to by a fairly large contingent of hams as CBFMC.
Oh.
Oh, yeah, slings and arrows.
Oh, hurts.
Yeah, well, hey, we won. Those of us who considered FM and VHF our home, we are now the predominant form of actual amateur radio on the air operation. So we won. I'll try to get through this quick. I cut out a lot of stuff. There's a lot of the Oscar stuff as they were building it. You know, transmission lines, something that we could have tried to understand, but I'm sure I didn't understand it. Some homebrew, VHF, 10-meter and 6-meter transceivers, homebrew. Never got to build something like that. Let's see. This is one of the interesting things is to see what's still in QST and what's not. And, I see what I highlighted down here. Let's take a look at that. June 30th, 1964. 256,237 hams. It had dropped a little bit. So right now we are sitting at around 730,000, 740,000 or so. Our big growth was in the late 90s when the technician went no code. So it's just interesting to see that that there was actually a falling off back in 1964. League membership, on the other hand, is currently at like 175,000 or so. There were of the much smaller pool, there was a much larger percentage, over 100,000 hams in the league, and as compared to, you know, total number of hams that there were, period. So the percentage of membership in the league is way down from what it was. The total numbers are up, but way down. That's kind of sad.
Yeah. It is too bad. You know, one of the guys I hung around with when I was out of college, and a single guy was Nick Berg, who's now a K9MB. He was the most frugal ham I think I've ever met. We would drive 100 miles for free dinner, you know, free bar food and buy one drink. That's how frugal he was. Well, I was over at his house one day, and he had the ARRL Life membership plaque on the wall, and we were both, you know, scrimping money. And I said, "How can you afford to do that?" And he said, well, you pay in quarterly installments. And I ran an analysis of how long I would be on this earth versus how much it would pay for dues. And I realized that this was one of the best investments I could ever make. So at that time, the ARRL was, I think, $15 a year, and they'd announced they were going to $17. So I went ahead and did my life membership, paid in quarterly for the next, I think, 2.5 years, something like that. And I've been a life member for years and years. So I probably the best investment I ever made was a life membership in the league. And they have kept Ham Radio going through thick and thin.
Yeah.
The other thing that I know that you interviewed the editor of CQ, and I would really encourage all hams to support CQ magazine. It's been around for a long time. They're doing the best they can in a troubled economy, especially in hard copy publishing. Their digital version is really quite good. So I would really encourage all hams to be members of the league, where you also get QST digitally. It looks great on the iPad. And to go ahead and subscribe to CQ, including the digital version. Make sure that that both of those, the organization and the magazine, keep going, because they're both really vital to the hobby.
Absolutely. And we all have disagreements with some policies from the league. They can't please everybody. And if you take your disagreement and make it into a, I'm not going to join or I'm not going to remain a member, that's kind of sad. You lose your voice, and Ham Radio loses a big part of its voice.
Yeah,
I became a life member in 1974. One of those snapshot memories that failed me for a long time was I thought it was like 1968 or so, and I was at headquarters, and they pulled out my application for life membership. And there it was, 1974. So, and I learned that probably when I was up there in the early 2000s. So that was
it
was very cool. So now I know when I became a life member.
That's still on my bucket list. I still haven't visited W1AW. I've looked at lots of videos. I want to go up there and operate. That'd be a lot of fun.
You got to go. Let me see what else I want to toss in here. I'll try to get through this quick because we got something else important. Hamming from your fallout shelter. I didn't even read the article. I just thought that was a cool thing to bring out. Novices, harmonics. Yeah, that's harmonics are kind of a thing of the past. The thing about this is not the article specifically itself, but the author. And back in at this era, this guy was the humor author. Come on. There we go. He was the humor author, W6ISQ, John Troster. You could count on QST having an article by him every couple of months, and always something fun and not technical, particularly technical. And, you know, I kind of like to think I haven't adopted his mantle. I'm trying to make my computer work right here. I've had the opportunity to write some reviews and other articles in QST, and I like to think that I write them differently than most of the other people that are writing things like that. Because I am an appliance operator. I have a very limited technical background. Good, solid depth of ham radio understanding and you know, pushing the buttons and a little bit about what goes behind the panel, but you know, if I'm reviewing a radio, it's not from the perspective of how good the engineers did their design, but how well that design translated into me being able to do something. So I kind of appreciated the articles like W6ISQ did. Not everybody did, and we'll see in a moment the result of that. This is something weird. I don't remember this at all. National calling and emergency frequencies. And on this page, it's got some of what they are.
Wow.
And there we go. This about half CW and half phone, and it doesn't say whether it's sideband or voice. But the idea is some frequencies, and these are not a proposal. These are something that the league was pitching to everybody. Some for calling and answering, some for emergencies only. You know, 21.4, 28. No, 29.64. Well, that's a little weird. There's no FM back then. I don't know who was operating up on 29.64. Now it's a 10-meter repeater frequency. 50.55, 145.35. People would tune up there. So those were kind of weird. It's just a little bit of strangeness from 1965.
Yeah, great idea, actually. I listen to 14300 whenever I'm not doing anything and in the shack, because to me that is the worldwide emergency frequency.
Yeah, the Maritime Service Net. And when 20 meters seems absolutely dead, there'll be big signals on that band. You occasionally could hear something pretty interesting, because boaters know to go there. If they can't reach the Coast Guard, they can't reach anybody else, there's a pretty good chance they'll find somebody there. And whether they're licensed or not, if they've got a true emergency, they can get on there, and they do. And the guys on that net will help out. So that's, yeah.
And the cool thing there also, if you just monitor and they don't have maritime traffic, they invite check-ins from everywhere in the world. So you can make sure your radio is working, and that also gets you to just listening in the background. So there's always a lot of ears on 14300. That's really a cool service, even now where we have sat phones and computer links and all that. There's still at least once a week you hear something on there that's very interesting.
There's a version of that on 15 meters that I checked into just the other day from my car. A guy in Iowa had a big signal. There wasn't another signal on 15 meters. It tuned up and down and up and down. And then suddenly, I think it was like 21415 or something like that. And and there he was. He was getting check-ins from all around the country. He was about the only one I could hear. So we're in a good spot of the part of the sunspot cycle. It wasn't supposed to be. The sun's gone nuts. I don't know if you noticed. The sun has gone nuts this fall and winter, when it was supposed to be falling away, and suddenly we're the best part of the sunspot cycle that was supposed to be at its downhill. So
quick time to sell your 10 meter only rig.
Hurry, well, get on the air and play. I'm having a good time. This is the Gonset Sidewinder 2 meter sideband. This was one of the early radios that I had. I had a lot more radios when I was a kid than I can afford now. I don't know how I was able to buy this stuff. I bought this used, I'm sure. It was an expensive radio at the time. There was very little sideband going on. This was before FM showed up as a big deal. In a review, reviews today don't have block diagrams. This is sort of a transition point. They used to have schematics like crazy, and there's no schematic of this radio in there. It was getting too complicated. It would fill QST, but they did have the block diagram. This correspondence from members, what is interesting about it for me is that it is 1, 2, 3 pages of people complaining about contest operating and, contests filling up the bands. So
that's still happening now.
It is still happening now. It, same as it ever was. So let's see. This is the
other cartoons, that Jeeves cartoons that show up every once in a while too. Those have been around for a long, long time.
Yeah. Gil. And he passed away a long time ago, but, it was also a big deal here. I just received my December QST. May I be frank with you? I'm bored with W6ISQ. Really? Enough is enough. So, I'm sure that my reviews rub the more technical hams the wrong way. They want to see technical stuff. I want really in depth blood and guts technology. I want to understand what's going on. I can't do that. But they still hire me to write reviews. Guys. So let's see. How's DX? That's just perpetual ham, big part of ham radio. Not part that I've ever been a big deal in. World about 50 megahertz. I think that the column's got a different name, but it's still around. This is gone. This was in QST for a long, long time, and I only sliced out one page, but it was it had been many, many pages. And they don't do that anymore. Maybe they gave up. I guess this is what I was looking for in the operating news. This gentleman's agreements. This is going back to the sideband and AM thing. They wanted to keep sideband and AM separate, and sideband ended up occupying the top end of most bands and AM the bottom end. And obviously sideband was growing, AM was shrinking, so slowly sideband took over. But the AM guys, it's the end of ham radio as we know it. So fighting tooth and nail to keep...
Donald Duck is what they called him.
Yeah, yeah, because if you tuned him in on an AM receiver, it sounded like... I do a good sideman impression.
Yeah,
you can almost understand them like you can almost understand Donald Duck. So let's see. I'm pushing the right buttons here. This this caught my attention as I was going through that issue. This is a national ad. National was a big manufacturer. You still see them at Hamfest a lot, but it was not one that was ever on my radar. But the interesting thing about this was they're talking about a digital frequency display in 1965. It was not digital in the terms of that we think of digital now. It was, you know, these little numbers here, they just, you know, they rolled as you turned the dial. But it did give you this digit was 100 kilohertz, and the resolution of most of the radios that we used back then was, or 100 hertz rather. And the resolution of most of the radios we used couldn't resolve a frequency to much better than a kilohertz, the good ones, and most of them not even close. So that was something interesting and new. But the thing about QST that got my attention all the time was the ads, and they were all mostly in the back of the magazine. So there's our Heathkit tour.
How much? $44.
Yep, $44 for the tour. I had one of these HW12s and 32s. I got some pictures of those coming up. There's Heathkit's more expensive line of radios, and you see these in Hamfest like crazy. This ought to interest you. Did you know? You remember Amateur Electronics Supply? I'm sure.
Yes.
It was a big store up in Milwaukee, and they still are. And I don't remember, I went to their store in Chicago. It's where I bought some of my equipment. I don't remember them changing the name to Sturman Electronics Supply, because they went back to Amateur Electronics Supply at some point pretty quickly, I think.
I didn't know that.
Could go through more QSTs and find out. But that surprised me when I saw it in QST.
Well, they're actually, back then, Allied Radio was around, and that was before it was called Radio Shack, and they had a huge, they called it the Ham Shack. About a quarter of the store was ham radio, and across the street was, if I remember right, Lafayette Radio, or maybe Olson Radio.
Newark. Newark. There was an Olson. Yeah, there was Lafayette existed, Olson Radio existed, and Newark existed, and they all had ham radio stuff in them. And yeah, I spent many, many hours in the Allied Radio store. And I remember their ordering system. I don't know if you ever did this. Bob and I tended to be evil now and then. So we would go down there, and you'd fill out this slip with what you wanted to order and turn it in. And you didn't hand it to someone. You just put it in a bin, and they would pick it up. And they would go back to the warehouse and find whatever it was and bring it up to the counter and come on the PA system and announce, this is Bart Simpson. And we were Bart Simpson. We would fill out an order for something, and the name we would put on it was CB Jammer. CB Jammer. And they would get on the PA system every time, just like Mo. PL-259 for CB Jammer. PL-259 for CB Jammer. Would CB Jammer please come to the order desk?
Oh, that's funny.
And then we'd be back there breaking up, trying not to show that it was us. And we probably did that four times a year, and they never
caught. Somewhere there's still a bin with four PL-259
waiting to be picked up. Well, that store is long, long gone. And sadly, Radio Shack is in not doing so well either.
Too bad.
We are absolutely not going to get to the stuff that I wanted to get to, because you got a football game to go to. So we will we'll have to come back. Are you frozen? I think your picture is frozen. Yeah.
I'm moving. Is the picture freezing?
Yeah, let's see. Oh,
there we go. I'm back.
I'm not sure what I had.
I went into hiatus there for about 10 seconds.
Yeah. So let's wrap up our nostalgia. You watch a football game, and then sometime soon we will come back and do this again and exclusively look at social media and internet stuff.
Because
you got a Cowboys game to watch.
That's true. It's going to be Ice Bowl 2, so that'll be interesting.
Where are they playing?
Green Bay, outside.
Oh, cool. I'll go tune that in.
Now they were saying the Cowboys were getting ready by practicing outside in Dallas when it was 35 degrees here, which is cold for Dallas. And they get off that plane and it's the wind chill's negative 25. So it'll be interesting to watch today.
Yeah. Are they calling for snow or just cold?
Just cold.
Because I love the snow bowls. I love it. Yeah. I love it when it's snowing so hard you practically can't see anything on the field.
Yeah. Yeah, well, you never know at Lambeau Field. It could come out of nowhere. I've been in Green Bay in the summer, and it's not really warm there even in the summer. So it'll be fun.
Yeah, brief diversion. My very first job in broadcasting, paid job in broadcasting, was not in Green Bay, but just up the road a little bit, Sturgeon Bay.
Sturgeon Bay, yeah.
WDOR. Shout out to all the hams in Door County, Wisconsin. And my friend back then, Lyle Henry, K9DKW. I change everybody's call sign into a 4, by the way. K9DKW, he's now K700 living out in Los Angeles in Hollywood.
Oh, that's great.
So I'm still swap email with him every once in a while. He got me
the
job.
Okay, that's all.
Yep. So we will do that, and in the meantime, we can finish this stuff up. But what I want to say about station activities is that disappeared from QST to much wailing and gnashing of teeth. But they realized there's the internet, and people can get that stuff from the internet. I don't know how many do. I don't know how many read it when it was around, except to see if your call showed up. Since we were both from Chicago, I decided to pull out the Chicago reference or the Illinois reference. And
yeah,
in 1965, I don't even know if I was a league member. What I do remember about ARL and Aries or the Public Service Corps that they called it back then, which is interesting because they're kind of sort of trying to go back to a name like that.
Yeah.
I've lost control of...
It's a Cook County EC, yeah.
Yeah, I've lost control of my my television studio here. And let's see if I can get you back in the picture. There we go. When in the 70s, when we were involved in the Chicago FM Club, we did some public service activity. We did, remember, March of Dimes and Project Leap?
Project Leap was
a
highlight of my ham career, being thrown out of an election box. That was pretty cool.
Project Leap was legal elections in all precincts. And this, we did this for several years in the mid 70s, obviously long before cell phones. And you know, people, if they think of Chicago, one of the things they think of is corruption. It was famous for it. And there was a group of lawyers that were, do-gooding, trying to, do some to help poll watchers and at least to make the most egregious corruption harder to pull off. I don't think they succeeded in actually stamping out any. And they realized that what they needed was a way to communicate rapidly. And someone must have had contact with ham radio. So we had this citywide coverage repeater. Some of the few people that were able to drive around in cars and talk on the radio citywide. An awesome capability that the public had no understanding of, but they figured out. So in the elections, they paired hams with radios with lawyers. And so a phone call would come in from a poll watcher saying some shady activity going on here in the 51st precinct. And we'd get that on the phone at one of their offices and then forward it to a lawyer in a radio car. You know, calling all cars, something shady going on in the 51st precinct, and they would go see if they could get there in time to actually see something shady still going on. I guess some. Yeah. So I was at one of the offices. You were in one of the cars?
Yeah, yeah. And I remember it was the Cook County attorney got on and thanked us at the end of the day because there were mostly deputized assistant county attorneys that were with us. They had the right to be in the polling places. We didn't. And most of us had Motorola two-way radios in our cars. We didn't have handy talkies that much back then.
Yeah.
But I remember going in with that attorney, and I could actually see in the ballot box, they had the curtain. I could see four legs in there, which meant somebody was in there helping somebody vote. And I said, hey, you can't do that. And they threw me out. They threw me out. And one of the guys, one of the hams got arrested. Remember, we got a call on the repeater, please come get me. I'm at the such and such police station. They'll let me go as long as somebody comes and says I'm not a criminal. It was a wild election day. Those were really fun.
Yeah, I think we did that for like two elections in a row, 4 years mm-hmm. apart. And yeah. my memory was I was in one of the offices. I was on the south side. Chicago was and still is highly racially divided. South side was primarily black. North side was primarily white. And we did not have really good repeater coverage in the mid-south side of the city. We had a receiver way down south in a southern right. suburb and one way up north, multiple receivers, no receiver downtown when we transmitted, an old GE voting system, well, new at the time, selecting between multiple receivers. But coverage in the mid-south side of the city wasn't very good. The election started at 6. We needed to set up a station at one of their offices, which was on the south side. This is part of the area where a lot of the corruption was happening. Nothing to do with the race makeup that I know of, except that's where things were a problem. And so at 4:30 in the morning, here's this suburban, as white as it can get, white guy, walking through a building in the midst of practically segregated Chicago. There are burglar bars on everybody's door and people peering out at me saying, there's something not right about this, carrying a big roll of coax and an antenna up to the roof of a five-story building to put the antenna up on the top and drop it down. And I was scared. And yeah. The people that were around me were the nicest people in the world, and I was a scared suburban white guy. It was very strange. But that was before the day of the bike-a-thons and walk-a-thons. Eventually, the March of Dimes caught up with us and used us.
Right.
So all of that was...
Actually, I remember the second election, I had finished up, and I had a Mustang II back then. It was a real new, little hot little sports car. I was driving in the middle of the south side, and the clutch pedal fell off. My car died in the middle of the street in a very... to me, dangerous neighborhood. I had no help except to get out of the car and walk to the closest gas station, explained what was up. And I was a suburban kid too, actually. And the people were so nice. They helped and got my car. They towed it to the gas station. They drove me to to someone that could drive me back to the suburbs. And I remember that day, I was so scared, and they turned out to be just the nicest people. So it's a really cool memory from Project Leap.
A lot of lessons, and society's not learned them very well, sadly.
Yeah.
That's not what this show is all about, but we do have some experience like that.
There was one other character that popped out in my brain in the middle of the night. Do you remember WB9FRE?
That does not ring
Herb
a bell.
Howard.
Oh, he Herb was, Howard. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Now, yeah, I know who you're talking about.
Traffic control. He had a station at the top of the Hancock building where WBBM traffic control.
Yeah. Yeah. Herb Howard, WBBM traffic control.
Right.
He talked
right.
a mile and a minute.
He would listen to us on the Chicago FM Club repeater. And of course, we couldn't say it took us 12 minutes to get from Dempster Street to the Edens Interchange. But in CUSO with other people, we could say, wow, I'm coming down the Edens Highway this morning, and there's hardly any traffic. And Herbie would pick that up. And on this is the CBS 50,000-watt Chicago back news station back then, still is. And they'd say, well, you know, ham radio reports that Edens Expressway looks great this morning.
Yeah.
So we got a lot of free airtime because of Herbie.
It was great. He had actually a remote console to the repeater. He didn't have to have a radio in there. We had wireline remote consoles, and he had one of those. And I remember thinking that he pushed the line a little bit now and then trying to solicit information, but it was a good public service. So,
that was really cool. Herbie was the one that helped me learn a lot, you know, introduced me to a lot of the folks like Van Gordon Sauter and Walter Jacobson and the guys that worked at CBS. And then they introduced me to the engineers that helped me build the studio.
Yeah. One of the engineers was Don, WA9DZS.
DZS, yeah. Indeed.
And don't know if W9JXT was at CBS or not. Was he one of the CBS guys? Yeah.
I'm not sure where he worked. And we had a whole bunch of hams from Motorola. And that's why we always knew it was coming from Motorola, because we had old tube radios. I remember I would drive, talking to somebody, I'd drive over railroad tracks and the radio would stop working and I'd have to get in the trunk and reset the tube. I'd be back on in 2-3 minutes. I got to where I could do it pretty quick.
Yep.
But the guys that worked for Motorola already had the solid state multiband test mobile radios in their cars.
Yeah, my first FM rig was an mobile radio, was an ADD, Motorola ADD, a Dynamotor 80 Delta. Dynamotor powered the transmitter, vibrator powered the receiver, thousands of tubes inside.
Every time you transmitted, you'd hear the whine coming out of the trunk and your headlights would dim.
Yeah. Two channels.
Yes.
I didn't use that on CFMC. I didn't have the frequencies for CFMC back then. I had something else in there. Mostly 9-4 simplex.
Yes, we used 9-4 simplex.
Mm-hmm. And back in the day before the band plan had been solidified or even contemplated very much. Jim King, WB9BDS, if you happen to be out there in the audience, I love you, guy. I've lost touch with you a long, long time ago. You were one of my mentors in the world of FM. Taught me so much. If anybody knows Jim King, he moved out to the West Coast, and WB9BDS has gone from... In any reference, he's probably, you know, not in ham radio anymore. But if anybody gets in touch with Jim King, KN4AQ at arvn.tv or arl.net.
There you go.
love to hear from him one more time.
You know, one of the things when I left Chicago, and I think you were president, but I was made a life member of Chicago FM Club, so I still get
the emails. Yes, by the way, what's up with that?
Yeah, how about that?
Yeah. They didn't make me a life member. Of course, I kind of left them in the lurch. I had life issues back then. Like I was saying earlier, we were in our 20s. I was a 28-year-old, 29-year-old president of the radio club, and at the time they made the president also the chairman of the big ham fest that they were running. Way radio over my head. And I got divorced, and I quit ham radio, and eventually a few years later left Chicago and got into drugs and stuff I'd never been into before, and it was just my life took a tailspin, which is why I kind of disappeared for 10 years from ham radio and then resurfaced when I moved back here to North Carolina, which is now 25 years ago and seems like it was yesterday.
Wow.
Oh, I told you there'd be cats. You have a cat, but you have locked your cat out because it would be all over the place. This is Maui Mouse. We have three cats, two blind tuxedo cats, and one three-legged cat. We specialize in cats that don't have all their parts. And in fact, my wife was out this morning. She was going to join me in celebrating the 50th anniversary of being a ham, but she was out doing a cat rescue, trying to trap a kitten behind a red lobster. So,
yeah, we have three rescue cats here. Sammy, who's 16, Squeaky's about 5. She doesn't meow, she squeaks. And then last summer when I was working on the Digipeter at the Cedar Creek Club, I opened my car door and a little tiny kitten about 8 weeks old jumped in the car. So she, of course, became Digi. And she's the one about every 3 minutes she sticks her paw underneath the ham shack door trying to break in. She also knocks everything down. And I know if she came in, she'd knock the camera down and then proceed to knock everything off the ham shack desk. Yeah.
When you say camera, you are you have a perilously balanced iPad that is
pointed at you. Yeah, this is an iPad Air.
Yeah, so.
Which I got stuck with Apple when the first iPod, so I'm still, I have an Android now and I have a Kindle, but my 30 gigs of music is still on Apple.
This is my studio. I guess the camera over there is not seeing the camera over there, but seeing the camera back behind me. There's the shot. So I've built a television studio. Cool. I can't really expect all of my guests to build TV studios, but you've had an awesome picture and good sound, so you're doing very well.
I'm real happy with the iPad Air. It's something else.
Have you had kickoff yet? Do you have a screen going?
Yep.
Have you had kickoff yet from the football game?
No, I think we're good for a little bit. Yeah, we're still good.
Yeah, I wanted to just go through the end of the QST stuff and a couple pictures that I had. Hammerland's a name that's long gone. This was something QST did a lot of and doesn't do so much anymore. Ads for commercial and military stuff. They were not trying to sell this stuff to hams. Actually, I think they were trying to, they realized that a lot of hams were in companies that could use this sort of thing. And they were also recruiting to hire engineers. The Squalo. Did you ever have a Squalo?
Yes. In fact, I have one right now for 6 meters. There's a guy, I think actually MFJ bought that from Cushcraft and they actually sell it. But there's a guy on eBay that builds a beautiful Squalo. And I have one for both 2 meters and 6 meters, about $100, and it's really well built.
Yeah, it was a square antenna. It was weird, and you can see this one down here. I ran one on a convertible because it was hard to put an antenna on a on a convertible, so I tied it. Those were suction cups at the bottom of the Squalo, but of course they wouldn't suction cup to a convertible. Excuse me. So I tied it down to the convertible. The Amico company, just nostalgia brand. I don't know if I ever had any of their equipment, but been around for a long time. But this is famous. Swan, you know, they're long gone, but everybody, if you didn't have one, everybody knew about the Swan equipment.
Yes, uh-huh.
And I talked to a guy who had resurrected a Swan recently.
Right.
And before he told me what it was, I could tell, first of all, that he was operating a legacy radio because he was not on an even kilohertz or 500 hertz. And, you know, whenever you're outside of contests, if you're talking to somebody, and outside of DX pileups, if you're talking to somebody and they're not on an even kilohertz, you know, they're running a radio that can't do that, the old legacy radios. Right. So I knew he was running a legacy radio, and I also was tracking him up the band. Swans drifted. They were notorious for drifting.
Exactly.
So I said, "You're running a Swan, aren't you?" And he said, "How did you know?" So because I've followed you at least 60, 70 hertz up the band, and you're continuing to go. Yeah, it's only been on about a half hour.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's see. What else do we have?
I had one of those for a while. It was a lot of fun.
I never had one, but obviously very famous. This radio is similar, but it never got the traction. In fact, it was more portable and smaller, and you know, everybody wanted one, but it's not something anybody remembers. This, however, is something people remember. Again, this is another one of those radios that those of us with tours lusted after because it had a superhet receiver and it was selective, still crystal control. And again, AM, they made an FM version eventually. And look at that price, $239.
Yeah.
Now, $239, and I say the words Waxon and Bofung to you.
Yes.
And by the way, I know I pronounced Waxon wrong. I know it's really Oxing.
I have one of each color. $35 each.
Yeah. Okay, back to this. $239 back to, hold that up again. Hold that radio up. $39. What the heck? And hams complain if they're buying an ICOM or a Yaesu and it's still $239. It's 1965 to 2015. That's 50 years of inflation. And the price is the same.
Yeah.
And hams complain. It's
Yeah,
that they're too expensive.
Pretty amazing.
They want the $35 radios. Dayton Hamvention, 14th annual. Ever been to Dayton?
Yes, a lot of fun.
Okay,
I haven't been there in a long time. I want to go again.
Yeah, my first Daytons were another 10 years down the road. Some of the Chicago FM Club guys that we hung around with would drag me along. And as president of the club, you know, people would accord me honors and respect far beyond what I actually deserved. But they would pay attention to me. And that was kind of cool. Very ego inflating. Your internet is failing you. You become very fuzzy and
I can see that.
You know, I've got a little meter here that shows me what's going on. I'll drag it over on top of your picture. And the red line is you, and the green line is me. And there's where you took your drop. So it should come back.
My wife might have decided to get on Facebook or something.
Yeah. Yep. You never know. Or it just could be your internet service providers decided to do something else. Yeah, do something else with their available bandwidth. So the 14th annual, it was pretty new back then. Some more VHF equipment that I was heard of, maybe not very familiar with. Did not become particularly famous, although Bob Heil probably knows what they are. The reason I wanted to point this out is because this is a good example of how dumb I was. That's not the shot I wanted. Don't know where the shot I wanted went to. Well, I guess that shot will do. This is an example of how dumb I was as a novice. My original radios were a Heathkit DX40 transmitter and a Hammerland receiver. I got pictures of them coming up in just a second. And transceivers existed. All my CB activity was transceivers. So they existed back then. Transceivers existed in ham radio, but they were less common. And a lot of these separate transmitters and receivers were common, and they needed a way to switch the antenna back and forth. And this was one of the most popular ways. There we go. What's in here is you got a coax connector, connect to the antenna, connect to the receiver, connect to the transmitter, and then just a relay, just a plain old relay to switch them back and forth, and some contacts that went out to a set of contacts on the back of the transmitter connected to the transmit switch. So when you threw the transmit switch, it would throw the relay, bringing the antenna from the receiver to the transmitter. Very simple concept, completely eluded me. I had no idea what that was all about, because I had done all the CB stuff using transceivers. I had some walkie-talkies, transceivers, so no concept. So characteristic curves, transmit receive relays. I was a licensed ham. I wasn't a general yet. I might have had a better idea what it was all about when I got my general. The moral of this story is getting a license is the beginning of learning, not the end.
Exactly.
There are so many people that complained about the dumbed down license tests and how easy it is to become a ham. But that's just your start. Let's get them. Then we'll teach them what a TR relay is for.
Absolutely. And 50 years later, we're both still learning, and that's pretty cool. I mean, that's why it's such a cool hobby, Dave Bell says, world's greatest hobby.
Yes. Did you see Dave Bell's interview?
Yes. Yeah. Great book, by the way. Hilarious, funny book.
Oh, I don't have it sitting here. I was going to talk about that. I got the physical book, and it was one of those that I stayed up until 2-3 in the morning reading until I couldn't hold my eyes open anymore. And it is a lot of fun. So world's greatest hobby. You can get it for a couple of bucks as a Kindle and $15 or so as a actual physical book for those of you that want to do that. Okay, just a couple more things. Football is coming. Nothing happens in the first quarter. Another Swan ad. Oh, and they were, this shows the price, I think, somewhere in there.
It was not cheap, as I recall. It was pretty.
Well, $400, $395, $400. So
a lot of money.
Yeah. And do you remember Trigger? We mentioned a lot of radio stores in Chicago, but we didn't mention Trigger.
That's right.
Did you ever go there?
Mm-hmm.
Somehow, I never never managed to get there. Oops. There's the shot I wanted. I never managed to get there. It wasn't that far away, and I could drive a car, but never went there. Well, they did not have a good reputation.
That's right. That's true.
I think it's too late to get sued now. So there was a phrase that I'm not going to mention here that based on a rhyme and a slur. So I'm not going to degrade the program by mentioning that. But folks always thought that the trade-in prices he offered were too low. The prices for radios he was asking was too high. We all drove up to Amateur Electronics Supply in Milwaukee and lusted after what we couldn't afford, and occasionally bought what we could. So anyway.
And then, of course, for FM, we all went to Spectronics.
Yes.
And bought surplus Motorola stuff from Art, K9TRG.
Yeah, Art passed away just a couple years ago. So
really nice guy. Yeah. He actually moved to Dallas before me and started ACL Electronics, I believe, here, and then moved back to Chicago. And that electronics store faded out after he moved back to Dallas.
It was a ham store?
Yep, it was a ham store and an electronics store, audio video. We have Texas Towers here in Dallas, which a lot of folks know. And then there's another ham store that's opening a few blocks away from Texas Towers, from what I hear. I can't remember the name of it right now. But interestingly enough, there's a out in East Texas, in Paris, Texas, there's a company called Main Street Trading that started out as kind of a catch-all store in a small town in East Texas, and they've become a premier mail-order ham radio store in the country, and are actually located in Paris, Texas, out to about 100 and something miles east of Dallas. So it's a success story just in the last couple of years.
That's like small town middle of nowhere, isn't it?
Yeah, it's.
I mean, if you live there, you're probably saying it's not the middle of nowhere. It's Paris, Texas.
That's a great town in the middle of the piney woods, but it's a long way from any big city.
Yeah. By the way, I did live in Dallas for one summer, 1972. I worked at KNUS, McClendon station. My dad wangled the. I don't know if they're still on the air with that call sign. It was 1972. It was early in the era of rock and roll on FM. Rock and roll was all on AM. FM was classical and beautiful music.
Right.
And they were an early FM rocker. And not hard rock. It was, pop music.
McClendon's real well known in the radio circles, though, because he did, he pioneered a lot of formats.
Yeah.
In fact, in
Chicago, he did WNUS, which was a news station.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. KNUS was not a news station. At some point, it might have been. Fighting the Mighty Cliff, KLIF.
KLIF, sure. One of my buddies here is Ed Bush, who worked for several of the talk radio stations and ended up here in Dallas. He lives down at Cedar Creek Lake, and he's president of our radio club. Still has that booming Ed Bush talk show voice.
Yes, what I always wanted to, I don't think I ever knew that I wanted to do talk radio. I always wanted to do radio, and anybody who's been watching this program knows I'm a wannabe radio person.
Actually, I wanted to do that too, Gary, and it just never worked out. I did a lot of industrial stuff, but never on the air except as N5 CSU.
Yeah, I tried it briefly after I left Chicago. I got a job as a disc jockey at KFWJ and KBBC in Lake Havasu City, Arizona.
Oh, my gosh.
And I had happened to travel through there. I did a long-distance motorcycle trip all summer long in 1986. I was trying to get off drugs. I failed at that point. Succeeded later. Went through Lake Havasu City. I had a video camera with me. I shot some video. And then looking for a job, I quit my job in Chicago, did the summer motorcycle trip, and ended up in North Carolina where my dad was to live with him for a little while. But was looking through the back of Broadcasting Magazine, and there was an ad for KFWJ in Lake Havasu City. And he said he had a little low-power television station license. He wasn't really using it. It was translating something from Las Vegas. And he's looking for a disc jockey, but someone with some TV experience. I had lots of TV experience. So I had some footage of stuff from Las Vegas, and I shot some extra stuff, and I sent him this little video. It was the most unique thing he got in terms of anybody applying for the job. So he hired me.
Right.
And then 3 months later, he was a ham, Lee Shoblum. I don't remember his call, but he was a ham. And he didn't know I was a ham at the time. I, for some reason, didn't put that in my resume, but he discovered pretty quickly when I got out there. This was in my inactive decade, though, so wasn't doing a lot on the radio. And I had a great time. I really loved it. I was a lot better than I thought I would be and not as good as I wanted to be. There was a guy on the radio in Chicago that some of you out there in the audience will remember the name of, and you had left before he came on the air. His name was Steve Dahl.
Yes, I heard quite a bit about Steve Dahl.
One of the original shock jocks. And he did a primarily talk show, which on the radio stations he was on, which were music format stations, created a continuous fight between him and the program director because they wanted him to play more music. And the people listening did not want him to play music, but the program directors wanted him to play more music. So that wasn't always a fun on-the-air fight. A brief example of the way he did his program, besides the fact that he was one of the first people to say penis on the air and stuff like that, in the Howard Stern mode. And he claimed that he did it first and Howard Stern copied him, and you know, who knows. But one of the things that he did so differently, because everybody else on the radio was being on the radio and the thing that they were being was on the radio. He had a guest, and he was talking to the guest on his show for probably more than 15 minutes. And the guy said, "When does the show start?" And he said, "Oh, the show started 20 minutes ago." The guest couldn't tell. The listeners were getting something totally different. And that was my, oh, wow, this is radio. This is the way radio should be. A lot of radios is that way now. A lot of talk shows do very casual, like we're doing right now. You know, is this a television show or is this just a conversation between friends? So I tried that out there. And of course, I got the memos, play more music. Mm-hmm. And I also tried to be a bit of a wise guy. And I made a serious error. I made fun of a sponsor. And longer story than I want to take time to tell. But I got a memo at the end of the day, or I got a memo instantly. See me when you're off the air. And I was off the air. That was it. I was gone. So normally getting fired from a radio station job is a career move, an upward career move. But for me, since I was doing drugs and drinking and stuff way too much, I was downward spiraling pretty badly at that point and was not able to parlay that. And, shortly after, a year or so after, in recovery from all that bad stuff, sent out resumes, a couple for television, a couple for radio, got two offers. Television offered, and here in North Carolina, a livable salary. A radio station offered me peanut salary in Virginia. And I said, I need to make money. So I went back to television. My heart has been heavy ever since. So now, as I'm retiring from the world of real work and spending, I'm not retired. My freelance clients, I'm not retired. I'm just doing less. I get to fulfill my fantasies here with my own little television studio, and people I get to talk to. Whoops, people I get to talk to on the internet.
Yeah.
So there we go. I got a couple more pictures. A couple more pictures to show. Is your football game on yet?
No, we're good.
Okay. So we leave Trigger. There was another one of the 6-meter antennas, the Halo.
Halo.
It doesn't say so in this ad, but we called it this, and I think one of the manufacturers called it the Saturn 6 because of the three rings. So yeah. I had one of those on the back of my dad's car too for a while.
And you remember back in the 60s, and I think they're still around, the 6-meter Club of Chicago was a big deal. And you'd see these cars driving around the city with these halos on the back of their car. And say, boy, when I'm an adult, I want one of those.
Well, I had one. I put on the back of my dad's car. I'll have the radio I was using in a picture in just a moment. And up on the north side of the city in the northern suburbs, and I don't know if you hooked up with these guys, the 6-meter Mobile Ears.
Oh, yes. Uh-huh.
Yeah. They met at
a... You had to work five of them, and you got a certificate.
Yeah, they met at a restaurant on Toohey Avenue in Skokie or Morton Grove or one of those northern suburbs.
Oh, Jack's. Yeah, Jack's.
Yeah. I wouldn't remember that to save my life, but that was it. And they hung out on 50.4 and actually created a fair amount of activity. And we could drive around using 6 meter AM on 50.4. And it wasn't like 2 meter FM. Well, actually, it was like 2 meter FM these days because you only occasionally got a contact. And that's what people are complaining about 2 meters is that you can't find enough people on the air. Evenings and weekends and stuff more likely. And they were famous for fox hunts. We did lots of fox hunts. They were great. Some of my favorite times. Okay, meanwhile, still trying to remember how to push the right buttons here. Let's see.
Looks like my video is still locking up occasionally.
No, it's something that's happening here as I'm trying to get to my Acrobat reader. And my Acrobat reader wants to show your face instead, and I'm not sure why. So let me see if I can get control. There we go. There's that Lafayette. This is just some of their radios. It didn't show their store, but they had a big store in Chicago. There's another radio that it priced a little lower than the Galaxy 3 anyway, than the Swan, although the Galaxy 5 was right up there. See him at a ham fest now and then, but never quite got the reputation. But here is something that you can be nostalgic for, but disappeared a long time ago. This is definitely a victim of the internet. Ham ads in the back of QST. And lots of little ads. The first page was what you see here, all QSL. So manufacturers, you know, QSL printers. Well, a few folks got some radios in there, but QSLs, 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 QSLs. And then a couple more pages in, and there are like usually 7 or 8 pages of this stuff. People selling radios. You know, sometimes old radios, sometimes new radios. Hammerland HQ129X. Drake 1A. Almost no one knew what a Drake 1A was.
Wow.
So anyway, the good old ham ads and the National Radio Company. Good radios I've heard, but you know, never high on my radar, but always there in QST. And I stuck this in because this was the back page and good old RCA back when they were the most trusted name in electronics and a real U.S. company, always advertised. They never made or sold any ham radio equipment, but they always had an ad in the back of QST. This is my entry into radio.
Oh, my gosh. Yep, me too.
My very first radio. My brother Andy and I got a pair of these for Christmas, soldered them using my dad's 120-watt Weller soldering gun, and I think that we basically melted solder over the entire circuit board, and they didn't work, and we were distraught. We'd been 12 years old at that point, and Dad took us to a Radio Shack store, not the big Allied Radio downtown, but they had one in a nearby suburb, and the guy said, "Well, we've got a warranty policy, but we've got a plan for contingencies like this, because we know that people will build these and not be able to get them to work." And his plan was for the same price as buying the kit radio, he took the guts out of ours, put built guts in, and charged my dad another $10 a piece. And they worked. And
that's a Nightkit
C100.
C100, yes. One channel CB radio.
Channel 7.
Yes, channel 7.
But another regenerative receiver, which meant you heard everything. So you heard stuff you weren't going to be able to talk to. And the controls that you're seeing.
And you could turn it, right? So that you could also, you know, listen on all 23 channels back then.
Well, I think you were listening on all 23 at the same time because the regen receiver. But there weren't very many people there. The controls are, you see all the controls. An on-off switch and a push-to-talk button. There was no volume control. There was no squelch. You turned it on and it made psh, and you either heard somebody or you didn't. And as my friend Jeff likes to say, you would stand 15 feet apart and say, "Can you hear me now?" 25 feet apart. Can you hear me now? 50 feet apart. Can you hear me now? Until you got to about 400 feet apart and you couldn't hear each other anymore. And you put them away. But that for me led to buying additional better walkie-talkies and eventually met Bob. Through somebody I met on the CB, I finally managed to get some real CB-er to answer me. And they said, oh, you need to meet this guy. And I met Bob, K9ZGT, and he showed me his ham shack. He was a year or two ahead of me, and then I inherited inherited his stuff. So that was my my entry. Here was my first station. Initially, the DX40, which is the radio in the upper left-hand corner here, and the Hammerland HQ110 receiver, and that was not my tour. That's just one I swiped off of the internet. And then the DX100 is the radio that I upgraded to when I got my General, an AM transmitter. So I was not on sideband when I first got on. And most of that stuff was put together by my brother, Andy, WN9MAB, although he let his Novice expire. Eventually, he got his General, WA9SBF. He long ago faded out of ham radio. And in fact, he faded out of life. I don't know whether he's alive or not anymore. He disappeared about 10 years ago. So if you haven't found Jim King, if you find Andy Pierce, he was engineer at some radio stations in Florida. He called my brother and said, I'm going on vacation. You might not hear from me for a while. About 10 years ago, neither one of us have heard from him since. So his ham license expired. I can't trace him that way. In any case, back to the radiophon. This was that radio I used on 6 meters with the Halo and the Squalo. I lusted after this radio for a long time. It's a 6 meter AM radio. I think it put out probably about, well, it put in input. They always measured input back then, 10 or 15 watts, probably put out about 5 or 6 watts. And it's where I learned that 6 meters could become a DX band. I talked to folks in North Carolina and stuff. When we were first licensed in 1964, it was the bottom of a sunspot cycle. If you spent most of your time on VHF, wouldn't have made any difference to you. But HF, my high school friends and I talked on 15-meter AM with no competition because the band was always dead. So we didn't have any anything to it was past the world's most famous peak of the sunspot cycle in the late 1950s, and I didn't see a sunspot cycle peak until early 70s, and at that point I wasn't playing HF anymore. I was off at college and stuff, so I didn't see a good sunspot cycle peak until a recent one, and happened to be on HF at that time, so that was pretty cool. So it was selective, but it wasn't very selective. Here was 500 kilohertz worth of the band, in a very small little piece of the dial. So, it was an interesting radio to play with, and I got the VFO. I think I talked my dad into buying that for a birthday or Christmas or something. I had each of these, Heathkit HW12 and HW32, mono banders on 80 meters and on 20 meters, my first sideband radio. That's it. It's telling me that it's all the pictures that I have slugged out, which means pretty soon you can go watch football.
There you go. I was thinking now, I had a Heathkit Shawnee and a Pawnee for 2 and 6. It was AM only, but they were matching, and somebody else had built them, so they worked. It was me.
Yeah, we didn't have pictures of those, but they were like that Hallicrafters and the Utica. They had some selectivity. They were low power AM radios back before FM became a thing.
Once I got on the repeaters, that was pretty much it for. I've been on FM since I guess about 1969. I've been continuously on the repeaters, either in Chicago or Texas since then.
You probably recognized it that we were maybe you didn't. We had armchair seats to a revolution in ham radio, the likes of which had never happened before or since.
Absolutely, yeah. And you know, we used to go to the Wheaton Ham Fest in the middle of winter. hopefully you could get your car out of the snow when you left.
Yep.
But I remember I had $150 in cash. I don't remember how I got that much money, but it was about 1972, I think. And there was a guy there that had just come back from Japan. He had two Trio six-channel Japanese radio. It was a little portable radio about size of a paperback book. He had bought two of these things, one for him and one to sell. And he was showing it, and there was this huge bunch of people that were looking at this because it was the first Japanese transistorized 2-meter transceiver. It transmitted 144 to 146 only and FM. And I ran up there with that $150 cash, grabbed that thing and said, I want this. So I remember being the first guy other than him in Chicago with a Japanese six-channel, 5-watt portable radio. And I could put it on the dashboard of my convertible Mustang back then and drive around. The microphone was a long, skinny thing, and you had to hold it like you were talking into a tape recorder. But that was Trio, which was owned by Kenwood, and then Icom? It turned out to be the TR-2200 when it was introduced in America.
Yeah, I think it was Trio Kenwood, when the first name that they came to the States with, Trio Kenwood.
I know we had to retune the radio so that it would transmit properly on 146 to 148, because the Japanese didn't have that part of the band back then. But that was, I remember taking a lot of guff on the repeater that I didn't have Motorola or GE in my car anymore. But then everybody wanted to play with it at the CFMC meetings. So yeah. That was the very first, the beginning of the Japanese coming in with the smaller radios.
The name that was applied to those radios as they started to become popular was rice boxes. They're rather racist.
And we had Motrak radios, which was the solid state Motorola radio, so they called it Japtrak also.
Yeah.
But you know, until then, you had to know enough to modify a commercial FM radio transceiver to be able to get on FM. There was no other way. You couldn't go down and buy something at the store. So you either knew enough yourself, or you knew somebody that knew enough themselves to keep those tube or early transistor radios working.
All the clunking going on in the background was me picking this up off the shelf behind me.
Oh, yeah. There you go.
This is an amazing radio. Anybody who's into old radios will look at this and say, what? That does not compute. A channel knob that goes to 12. Yeah. On a Motrak radio. I bought this from some ham in Chicago. It fell off the back of a truck accidentally, I'm sure, $400. Right. It had two separate receivers in it so that it could receive different parts of the band, because these receivers were so selective that you couldn't go more than a couple of megahertz. This was 70 centimeters. Here's the right picture. 70 centimeters and the 440 band.
The great plastic microphone.
Yeah, plastic.
Still the best microphone made to man, except for Bob Hiles,
yeah,
of course.
Yeah, it was a big microphone. I love these microphones. This is not the radio. This is the control head. The radio plugged into a huge cable sitting in the trunk. This was my modification to put a touch tone pad on it. So got that in there. So that was my absolute pride and joy back then. And the first UHF radio I had that actually worked. I had a couple of other Motraks that, like you, I would go over a bump and they would stop working. And I'd go back with a screwdriver and pound on them. Every once in a while, I'd take a soldering iron and try to find where the bad solder joint was, but I could never find it. So I finally got this. Also, from that same guy, did I knock down from that same 200? Guy? HT220. The plate fell off of it. The plate fell off. This is only a 4-channel radio. And it had the Chicago FM Club UHF repeater in it. Of these 12 channels, only two were ever filled. That was That was pretty sad.
We had to buy the crystals, and they weren't cheap.
Yeah, and channel elements, crystal heaters, to keep them from drifting all over the place, especially on 70 centimeters.
Yeah, yeah.
So we could go on like this forever, and I ask the audience's indulgence in, I'm sure many of you have enjoyed our trip down memory lane. A substantial number of you are fairly new hams and didn't know what it was like back then. So that was my goal. And a lot of you are from back then or even farther back and, you know, just kind of enjoying the reflections. So many of you had different ones, a lot more HF for a lot of you. At this 50-year point, we are at a big bubble. Although I was looking at that statistic about ham radio in the 250,000 or so range and falling off a little bit, but it continued to grow after that. But population wise, we're the leading edge of the baby boom, and so now there are going to be a lot of hams that are doing this 50-year thing. You know, not that unusual. But as I go through the radio club and tell people I'm, you know, Sunday is going to be my 50, not very many other people are ahead of that. And a lot of people came after. So I'm kind of proud of us. We made it.
We've lasted this long and we're still active.
Yeah.
The interesting thing is at the Cedar Creek Radio Club, which is out in rural East Texas, I'm vice president of, we're graduating about 16 to 20 new techs. At least twice a year we have classes. The majority of the folks are actually already retired, and they wanted to get their ham license and never got around to it. But we're trying to attract the the next generation, the 30s and 40s, and we've even got some teenagers now that got their license. So it really is incumbent upon us old timers, it's hard to say, to make sure that ham radio survives and still is vital. 50, 100 years from now, it really is the coolest hobby, and it's been a major part of my life.
Did you ever have a time off period?
No. The only time, 1 year at Dayton when I was away at college, I did not have a radio. But ever since then, I've been involved in one way or another. And when I retired, I wanted to learn all the new modes. And I still haven't gotten past, I still play with PSK31 and D-Star. But I still got a whole bunch of modes that I want to learn, and a lot still in ham radio I haven't tried after 50 years.
Now, are you fully retired, or are you working part time someplace, or something to keep you going?
I'm retired, and it's been almost 3 years now that I retired from Raytheon. So I do a lot of pro bono public relations, communications. That's the field that I was most comfortable with, and helping out with social media and some of the nonprofits that I work with.
Cool. Amazing. Sitting right here in this split screen, ladies and gentlemen, 100 years of combined ham radio experience. And considering that this is the, that we just finished the 100th year of ARRL, as I was looking through some of these old QSTs and stuff, 64, they were ballyhooing their 50th anniversary. So yay for us. All right.
By golly. Hi.
All right. This could go on forever. So we will just pull the plug and let you go watch the Cowboys. No allegiance to the Bears. Duh, Bears.
It's still in my heart. And I do like the Packers, too. But when you live in Dallas, if you're not a Cowboy fan, you're on the next train out of the state.
Yeah.
So we'll see what happens. But let's do this again. Let's talk social media and the internet. And, I got on the internet when it was called the Micronet, and there were four of us. So we can talk about some of the early days of the internet, and then all the way up to some of the stuff that I'm doing with the Cedar Creek Club to keep it going and use the internet tools to communicate with, and so forth.
Yeah, because I wanted to bookend this interview or this conversation with the old stuff that we've been doing with the new stuff. So we'll just have to do that as a separate show.
Yeah, I think we've probably run out our viewers by now.
Yep. Have you ever made it to the end of a Ham Radio Now show?
Yes. Yeah, I have.
You know how they end?
I guess I haven't.
Ah, because they are famous. They're legendary for the folks that make it to the end. And only I look at the YouTube statistics and I see how the audience drops off after the first 5 minutes. I've lost more than half. And by the end, it's about 20% or so, from especially long ones like this. So if you haven't made it to the end, then you're in good company. I say something that I got from Dick Tracy. I started this back when I was on Ham Nation, did Ham Nation a couple of times, well, six times. And I did this once, and somebody emailed me and said, that's bad radio procedure, it's meaningless. And I, you know, since somebody criticized me for it, I'll do it all the time, just, you know, to be a butt. It is the phrase over and out. And has been pointed out many times to me, if you say over, that means it's your turn to transmit and I'll be listening. And if you say out, that means I'm going to be gone. And I interpret that as, you can talk, I won't be listening. And so when I sign off with a guest, I will announce who we are, and I will give myself the over part, and you can have the out part.
That sounds
so
good.
It works like this. Oh, by the way, I forgot to do this at some earlier point. That guy back there, Arvin, the Ham Radio Now chief financial officer and mascot. If you've made it to this part of the program, you have clearly had a good time. And if you've not contributed, that's how I keep my ends together. So stop by this web address here, hamradionow.tv. Click on, what site is Arvin going to be on? I don't remember. Click on Arvin's icon and whatever it's worth to you. That's all I ask. And hamradionow.tv. Back to the split screen. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Now you say who?
And I'm Rick Casey, N5CSU.
Formerly WA9LRI, formerly WN9LRI, formerly WANN9NSO, National Security Organization, someone pointed out. Over.
Out.
Perfect. You did it. Football time. Are you,
adios.
Are you ready for some football?
There you go.
All right, Rich. I will be
Take
in touch
care.
Soon. Let me blip this thing
great.
Off. Bye-bye.
Adios.